Hi everyone, my name is Meg McCarrick and I'm an application scientist at ChemAxon. I'm going to talk today about how we might handle the cheminformatics challenges of dealing with massively large virtual libraries. Then I'll drill down to an example, which is DNA-encoded libraries. This is what I mean by real in the title, because you can screen a huge library of real compounds using that technology. For some context, I'll start with some well-known and very large diverse libraries. How many of you have searched large online databases like eMolecules, for example? Large diverse vendor libraries like these are great for enriching your corporate HTS screening deck. And if you're a computational chemist like me, you've probably downloaded a ton of large databases like this in order to run virtual screening campaigns. One problem that tends to get larger as our screening libraries expand is the cost of running an HTS screen. For this reason, companies with huge libraries sometimes forgo screening of the full deck on all their projects. It becomes expensive to buy these compounds, run QC on them, and screen them. Compared to a huge diverse compound library, full combinatorial libraries were explored a lot in the 90s, with limited success compared to the sheer numbers of compounds. For a while, it was thought that these libraries were not diverse enough, or too large, or covered too little chemical space. Early libraries tended to be filled with compounds like amines, or amides, and compounds with low solubility, and not the most interesting functionality. However, a lot has changed in the 30 years when it comes to combinatorial libraries. Mainly the way we use them, design them, and even think about them has changed. Enamine, Boehringer Ingelheim, Pfizer, Merck, and many others have developed extremely large virtual libraries, which are meant to represent the full chemical space, which is easily, or at least somewhat easily, available to synthetic chemists. They combine the knowledge of available building blocks, including proprietary ones, with well-validated reactions and reaction rules. Making and screening all of these compounds would still have a huge price tag, not to mention how many resources would be required. But that's not a problem because people think differently about these libraries today. They can be used as virtual libraries, which are an information source to help gather ideas and generate ideas. If the ideas are compelling, then the compounds are made in smaller focused libraries, or even as single compounds. But wait a minute, 10 to the 20th virtual compounds? How are you going to store those, even as a virtual compound? How much disk space is that going to use, and how long will it take to screen virtually? Here we run into another resources issue. More efficient ways of representing the virtual library are used rather than a set of chemical compounds. Now I'm going to go into the target of my talk, DNA-encoded libraries, which are a special case of combinatorial libraries. There are many different variations on this type of library, but for today's discussion, let's assume a traditional DNA-encoded library setup, where DNA is attached to a linker and then directly attached to the small molecule of interest. Each time a reaction occurs with a chemical building block being added to the small molecule end, a corresponding oligonucleotide tag is added to the DNA end of the system to record which building block is being used. Split and pool chemistry is used for each cycle, and in the end, you can put all of the compounds, usually in the millions, into one well for affinity-based screening. Wow, that is efficient. Current DNA screening techniques have evolved enough to give a signal even for a really minuscule amount of DNA, so after washing out the compounds that don't bind well to the target, sequencing tells you which tags are enriched, thus they bind well to the target. A lot of technology goes into designing DELs, and I really admire people who can do this. I think it's going to be increasingly important as a piece of the hit-finding process in pharma in the future. It's really taking off now, too. So you're probably wondering, well, how does this relate to the ChemAxon UGM, and why are you even talking about it? I'm talking about it because it caught my attention, and I wanted to explore how cheminformatics can add utility to this type of research. And here's one important way in which I see our tools as being relevant to designing DELs and other combi libraries. Sure, we have tools that can calculate relevant physical properties. We have really robust enumeration tools called Reactor, where you can add reactivity, selectivity, and exclusion rules. And we even have tools to prepare libraries for virtual screening, such as 3D conversion, protonation, and tautomerization. But I think one of the most powerful aspects of our tools for this purpose is that we're able to manage and represent compound libraries at three different levels. First, you can represent a DEL library or a combinatorial library based simply on a set of reactants and the reactions to convert them to products. This is great if you want to store information about your reactants and reactions. It's not ideal as a way of storing final activity or other data, although I suppose you could think of it as sort of an R group decomposition, so maybe. The second way is you can use Reactor or other tools we have to fully enumerate the DEL or combinatorial library into its component compounds. Obviously, at a certain size, this becomes less feasible. I'm thinking 10 to the 20th, not so feasible. But it's just fine for many large libraries in the high millions or even in the low billions. And third, you can represent even enormous libraries in Marcouche space. A Marcouche structure, which I'm showing on the lower right, represents a full combinatorial set in terms of a core scaffold and R group definitions. And these libraries can be made easily with our tools such as Reactor, Marcouche Editor. I use the JChem9 extensions quite a bit, and then some of our other tools have plugins for these. Now I wanted to go into an application study. However, I'm going to call it more of an application story, and that's because I'm not looking at quantitative experimental results in SAR. I'm just thinking about the process and how our tools can help to make the ChemInfo challenges of dealing with huge compound libraries easier for you. So here is a hypothetical workflow. Let's say I'm a researcher working in a group that creates DNA-encoded libraries, or working with a collaborator who does this. In this scenario, I'm involved in early drug discovery, and I found this starting molecule in the literature. I like this particular reference compound because I know that I have some DNA-encoded libraries with a similar but not exactly the same core. So this might be a good scaffold hopping exercise. First, I would check Kemble or my other online sources to see what's most similar that's known and available, and also what type of activity data is known for those similar compounds. It turns out in Kemble there are 478 hits with the core as drawn, and these compounds have over 3,000 bioactivities, so quite a bit is known about the activities, so that's worth looking into. And then next in this scenario, I want to know if any of the compounds in my existing and already prepared DNA-encoded libraries are similar to this reference compound. Is it possible that I could have a hit within this in these DEL libraries that I've already made? And here, similarity is kind of a loose term. It really depends on the metric and how you're measuring it. So, personally, I prefer to cast a broad net at first and measure similarity using several metrics, actually as many as I can. And then I can always narrow it down later once I examine the hits from the search. So ChemAxon has a particularly rich tool set for things like similarity and substructure searching. As many of you are aware, this is one of our strengths. We have MADFAST, which can do really fast similarity comparison on huge enumerated compound libraries in the millions, and even we have a library of over a billion that we've worked on. We have recently developed or reintroduced some additional tools for similarity, the rule-based search using MCS and the LEAP2 search. Both of these operate on non-enumerated libraries or Marcouche space. The same is true for our newest substructure search method, which is also a rule-based search. Here I'm showing just the top two hits from each of the new methods. On the left, you can see that the LEAP2 search gives quite diverse results, with a morpholine-containing substituent, a pyrimidine core, and this library doesn't contain anything with a pyrazole as the query compound, and it doesn't come up in any of the results. So here I should point out that I've chosen to represent the DNA attachment point in this particular library that I built as a carboxylic acid for simplicity. You don't have to build a library this way, it's just a choice I made. You could use a capping group. You could even, if you really wanted to, you could build in the entire DNA. The second rule-based similarity search, which is the center two compounds, gives smaller and simpler compounds than the one on the left, which is the LEAP2 method. So the rule-based similarity search, you can see the similarity to the reference compound. The side chain has a pyrimidine, just like the reference compound, and both examples have a directly attached morpholine instead of a more distantly attached morpholine. And here I should definitely point out that in a huge combinatorial library, where let's say each R group is represented at least hundreds of times, you'll get many search hits with almost the same similarity value. So for me to just show you two of them is not really representing this set very well, but I don't have space to show you more. And finally on the right, this is the rule-based substructure search. It's quite similar to the center example, but note that in order to get a substructure that matches, I had to clip off a lot of parts of the reference compound. So you can see that my query structure is a bit truncated. And then the hits likewise are missing a few bits from the reference because it wasn't part of the search. But if I were to save even more of the hits rather than just the top two, I could get to the larger molecules that have some aryl groups like the reference. So this is just a tiny sampling of the search results. And I wanted to note that these new searches are not quite products. They are available through consultancy, so just ask us if you're interested. And at this point, I'm thinking of another similar workflow. Let's say we have screened the DEL libraries already in this hypothetical case, and there are a few issues that are DEL specific. I guess you could say that any type of screening has issues, but for DEL libraries, the DNA copy number doesn't always track with binding affinity, and that's kind of your readout of the hits. And also there could be false negatives if a reaction fails or an alternative reaction occurs, or the DNA has some issue, the DNA integrity, or there's noise. And there's also some false positives possible because DNA, there is a big chunk of DNA attached to this tiny molecule and it influences binding. And the selection method, so if you're washing off all the non-hits, there are so many compounds in the library that you may not get a strong selection of only the hits. There may be some noise there. So it could be useful to retrieve not only the hits, but also similar analogs for confirmation. This is just another step in my hypothetical workflow. And here's how I was thinking it might go. To somewhat address these issues in primary screening, it's always a good idea to check a few closely related non-hits. And of course, this depends. If you have an abundance of hits, you won't be as interested in this. But if your hits are kind of sparse and you really wish you had more to work with, this is one way you could expand your follow-up without running a new screen. You can look in reactant space for similar reactants to your hits. You could look at fully enumerated space or Marcouche space for similar compounds with the methods I mentioned. And you could do the substructure search. Again, you would do this in Marcouche space. And you don't have to just search one library at a time. These methods work across, you know, you can load up as many DNA-encoded libraries as you want to search for these similarities. So to sum up, Searching large libraries can be a technical challenge, and ChemAxon has a lot of tools that can help you. We can do MatFest similarity on fully enumerated libraries. We have these new rule-based search tools to do similarity and substructure searches in Marcouche space. We have our Marcouche tools, lots of ways to design, edit, view, and search libraries in this space. I'm showing a screenshot from Marcouche editor, and this is a DNA-encoded library example. And then the GChem9 extensions, I relied on that to build some of these workflows, although I'm not showing it, but those can be very useful as well. So I'll leave you with a tip for navigating these massive compound libraries. Try to have the right tool for the job. It makes it much easier. For instance, if I was trying to mow my front lawn, I wouldn't want the tool on the right, the big fancy tractor mower. I would just want a push mower because my yard is tiny. But if I were in charge of maintaining a golf course, I might want that giant mower, and that would be cool. So always have the right tool. It makes the job a lot easier. And I want to thank you for your attention.